I'm glad that I can share my research activities on musical AI with you today. And I'm going to try to give you first my research perspective, and then I will try to give you a more honest explanation of my long-term research activities and how things developed. But before that, let's talk a little bit about the research perspective. So as Nicola mentioned, I like being interdisciplinary. And from the very broad view, my career tries to integrate, tries to look into the topics where art and technology is together. In that sense, I'm involved. My background is being a musician as well as an engineer. But at the same time, in time, I expanded into a bunch of different, you know, artistic disciplines. And I really like being multidisciplinary. And in terms of arts, as we see on the left, I had projects involved in movement competition, and thus dance, visual arts, and then moving images. I love live performance, of course, and everything around that. And anything related to music, like composition, live performance, and instrument playing, and all that. On the right, I've been involved with quite different kinds of technologies, but mainly my concentration is on machine learning and artificial intelligence. And artificial intelligence in the broader sense, what I call applied artificial intelligence, that is not the general AI. That is, I'm not trying to make a system that could cook and play music and dance at the same time. That's general AI, right? But in my understanding, I'm trying to focus on algorithms that would do one thing at a time. For example, you know, it generates a chord generation, it chooses a sound for you that you think it's going to be cool. So in that sense, I'm interested in applied artificial intelligence. And there are quite a bit of algorithm types there. And so that's my concentration, but also it expanded to different, you know, technologies such as virtual reality as I started different collaborations. And in between art disciplines and technology, we of course have human-computer interaction. I've published a little bit on effective computing, which is understanding the emotional, understanding the effect of a content. And I published a little bit of effective computing in sound. And I'm also interested in design because I'm really interested in research through design and SOMO aesthetics and SOMO-based design principles. It's really important to look into musical AI and in broader sense, applied artificial intelligence for arts from a different perspective, because it's different than conventional AI. In conventional AI, let's think about Google Maps, right? It's trying to give you the shortest possible route if you want to reach to one place from another place. And then there, you have what we call a good fitness function, or how to say, your problem has a measure of optimization. As an objective measure, you know if one route is longer or shorter than the other. That it's really not that complicated to calculate that. But if you think about it, in musical performance or in, let's say, musical composition, there's no such objective measure. We don't have something like a ruler to, you know, measure if one composition is better than the other. People have different subjective opinions, and then we can even discuss, like, do we need that for artistic applications. So in that sense, applications of machine learning and AI is different for music and arts than the applications and than their conventional applications, because we are not trying to optimize anything. So this sits at the core of my research. And then in that sense, in that situation, error, in my opinion, is welcome. And if you look to the history, we noticed that there are moments where in engineering, something would be considered as like, you know, not appreciated, not liked, not preferred. But in music, they made substantial changes. And a very good example of that is FM synthesis, frequency modulation. I'm not going to go into the details of FM synthesis, but it's basically you have an oscillator that creates a sound and you have another oscillator that's oscillating the frequency of that first oscillator. When you do that, you can end up with multiple frequencies generated at the same time on top of your fundamental frequency. And here in the spectrogram, which shows us as different frequencies in time, we see a fundamental frequency and the side bands, the additional frequencies generated on that, on top of that. And if we go back to 60s, 70s in telecommunication, this was totally not preferred, right? If you have, if you're trying to send some sort of data or through or a communication through a cable, and then it's in one frequency, you don't want the other frequencies to appear. But this is not the case in music, and Chowning, being a brilliant researcher, he proposed the FM synthesis, where we actually acknowledged and like welcomed sidebands. And then now FM synthesis is in everywhere in music, and we can, you know, it's ubiquitous. So in that sense, that error made into a substantial change in audio synthesis and technologies for music. So I also take that approach and put it into today's technologies and tools, including machine learning and artificial intelligence, where I think we have something different. We have more of an research through design methodologies happening, and then the errors sometimes can be welcomed there. And then human-computer interaction is also important, because in arts, it's not like we always end up with one thing and we finish that process. If you think about it, a career of instrument playing is lifelong, and you continuously change, and within those changes, you generate more and more artworks, right? So there's I think similar thing happens when you use technology for music, and also technologies for machine learning and AI. And that happened to me in my career. And I want to get into the details of that a little bit today and give you a brief view of my experiences with using AI algorithms for musical performance. I want to give an outline of my all research activities. As I mentioned, at the core, I'm interested in musical audio generation. So, you know, in musical AI, there's quite a lot of research on symbolic music generation. People try to, you know, generate chord progressions, people try to generate melodies, people try to generate like sonatas, Bach chorales, and all that, polyphonic music, monophonic music. But I am looking from a different perspective, where I try to generate raw sound. And that is because I'm really interested in this ideas behind generalized understanding of music, where we think music is nothing but organized sound, which I will come in a second. And there, any sound can be used in musical ways. So this is a little bit different than, you know, symbolic music or notated music or MIDI generation. And at the core of my research, as I mentioned, there is a musical audio generation, and I've been running a couple of projects, and then two different approaches appeared in those projects. One was using discrete latent audio space, and then the other one was continuous latent audio space. When we mention latent space in machine learning, we mean that you create a space where you organize your input data in a manner that similar data points locate closer to each other. This is very common in machine learning. You know, you have seen maybe those like face changing videos or other types of like generative adversarial network videos. And there, they are actually just passing through that latent space and creating an image per frame. And that appears almost like a change. So we see that almost like a smooth change, because similar data points locate closer to each other in a latent space. And I'm trying to do that in audio, and I'm trying to find that how I could use such space in musical performance in my practice. And then from there, I started a bunch of collaborations, and I've been involved in different projects that included 3D graphics and creative coding, moving images using deep learning. Computation and robotics related research. But today I want to spend quite a bit of my time on musical audio generation. And then in the beginning of my doctoral studies, I first started by looking into what was available in the literature. And I'm really interested in live performance and improvisation. So I've been looking into the specific type of algorithms that are called musical agents. Musical agents are different than other generative algorithms because they have perception and action capabilities. So in that sense, they are like sort of this really cool type of algorithms that you could play together. So I wanted to make one of those, but before that, I delved into the literature. I tried to come up with a taxonomy and, you know, what is out there pretty much. And we come up with a taxonomy and the publications out there. I'm not going to go into the details of this. And if I would do this today, perhaps I would approach it in a slightly different way. But it also initiated a really cool another question, that is, what is interactivity? Like, especially if we talk about musical performance and improvisation, in that scenario, what is interactivity? And I'm still interested in the specifics of it. Not only, I'm not trying to, like, you know, have one sentence that defines interactivity in musical performance or something. I'm not interested in that. But like, what are the specifics, especially if we are involved, if we involve autonomous algorithms in those situations? And then in the taxonomy of musical agents, in that paper, we came up with 6 levels of interactivity. But these are specific to the software agents, the musical agents, the AI agents. It's giving a little bit of a hint of a broad understanding of interactivity in musical performance, but you know, it's still, I consider this as a first attempt. So here we have 6 levels. First one is reactivity, that is, agents respond to the changes in the environment in a timely fashion. That is, let's say I see someone playing and I stop playing, right? Proactivity is agents, where agents can perceive their environment and plan future actions. I know that in 2 minutes we will all stop playing and we will have a silent moment for 5 seconds because we talked about it before. We have a plan, we all know about it, and we act according to that plan. Interactivity happens between two agents, where I make an action, for example. Let's say I'm playing quietly, and suddenly I play something loud, and someone else who wasn't playing yet, they start playing too. So there's this bidirectional connection between performance when we talk about interactivity. In adaptability, agents learn from their environment to improve themselves. And this is interesting because when we talk about machine learning, we talk about a lot about unsupervised learning or other types of learning. And this is adaptability. If you think about adaptability, you can also think about maybe real-time learning for those algorithms. Versatility is when agents are domain independent. I think in one work, I sort of got close to this, where, you know, the same architecture could play different musical styles, but I'm still, I would be hesitant to say that algorithm achieved versatility. And then the last one is volition and framing, where agents can explain why they choose certain actions when they ask by others. I'm not sure about this level, but this is more about, you know, where agents can communicate on a higher level. Okay, so this was more like a, you know, a first attempt on interactivity in software agents for musical performance. And then from there, I was really into research through design. As I mentioned, you know, research is a more like an evolving process where you output your work in different times. And then that happened to me, that where instead of creating one work and then putting that out, mine evolved into more of a process. And we see that a lot. We see the other kind a lot in AI research, where researchers get together, they make an algorithm, they publish that algorithm, and then they compare that algorithm to the other algorithms. And then these algorithms, they try to achieve one thing. And in music, it's very common that the researchers come up with an algorithm that produces a final composition. And this is not new, actually. Since 1980s, we have seen these type of algorithms. For example, Ebgioglu's work is very well known on generating Bach chorales using expert systems. And that's another point. I think we should consider each algorithm types equally. Even the good old-fashioned AI, that's called expert systems, can achieve really promising results, as in Ebgioglu's case. But I'm really not into, you know, generating a bunch of compositions and putting them out. I don't want to make a final process. I don't want to make a final product. I'm more interested in the process of generating that product. That's, can I play with it? Can it play with me? Can it react to me in real time? Can I sort of involve the algorithm in my artwork production process? So in that sense, that is my focus, human-computer interaction in a way that there is, we can talk about co-creativity or augmented creativity. And then in detail, I want to move into discrete latent space. But before that, I want to again come back to my understanding of music that is coming from actually this idea of organized sound that's proposed by a composer called Edgar Varèse. And he's calling, he's mentioning that I decided to call my music organized sound and myself not a musician, but a worker in rhythms, frequencies, and intensities. It's really cool, this idea of approaching music as an organized sound. But then at that moment, I was trying to, you know, come up with an algorithm that I could play with on stage. So then my question was, if music is organized sound, then how could I make a computer organized sound? What kind of organizations would be in there? And I come up with two types of organizations, organizing sounds in audio space so that we can differentiate one audio from another, and organization of sounds in time so that we can make musical form. And then these two types of organizations has become, you know, main activities of my research. And then from there, this is maybe 7-8 years ago, I delve into discrete latent audio space because, you know, at that time, that was the only possibility. And in discrete latent audio space, what I'm talking about is you have a space where each input data is a sound sample, which is a couple of seconds. It's almost like an audio sample that you would use when you produce music with your Ableton Live or another DAW, right? So I'm trying to organize them. And to do that, I come up with a system, with an architecture called Musical Agents Based Self-Organizing Lab. And the discrete latent space in this algorithm called MASOM, discrete latent space in MASOM is handled by this machine learning algorithm called Self-Organizing Maps. Okay, so let's get into the details of how this architecture works. So we have three things going on: segmentation, machine listening, and machine learning. First of all, this algorithm learns from a data set of audio recordings. You just need an audio, and it could be any audio. And then with segmentation, the algorithm tries to first find sonic gestures. These are like specific sound events that are a couple of seconds. And segmentation is a big topic in music information retrieval, so I'm not going to get into the details. But like the idea is that, okay, I give the computer a audio recording, could be as long as it doesn't matter how long it is, and then the algorithm can find individual sound samples within there. And then I need to label these sounds. I need to label each sound with a specific feature vector to define it, to find what kind of sound that is for the machine. So I come up with a feature set of timbre features plus loudness plus the duration of the audio segment and music emotion recognition features, which are pleasantness and eventfulness. I get a lot of questions about this, about effective computing, because it's not that much of a known area in arts and music. So I want to give an example of it and showcase how it works. So here, each dot is a segment from Stockhausen's composition, and it's from Contact. And we will see a couple of examples from there. And here the grids are, y-axis is arousal. That is if a sound is calm or quite eventful. And the x-axis is valence. If it's almost like if a sound is more like a dark sort of like a sadness type of sound, or more like a bright or like a happier sort of sound. So let's see how this works. First an eventful sound, and then a calm sound. And then a pleasant but natural eventful. High eventful and pleasant. And less pleasant and eventful. So I was really excited that I come up with some sort of labeling where it's not low level such as timbre features or spectrogram, but it's a little bit more higher level where I could, you know, differentiate sounds depending on their eventfulness. And that was really exciting. And I mean, I'm pretty sure people have a lot of questions about this. We have like 3 publications where we did user studies with participants and they agreed on their ranking in different levels, and the statistics and the all results are available on these publications if you're interested. So I started from this. When I started making Masom, I started from this. Can I have a musical agent that would work on a higher level information such as pleasantness and eventfulness? And then from there, actually, in the, you know, iterative design process, I listened to the outputs of the algorithm and I noticed that, hey, it doesn't really know what timbre is. So I added timbre features, which are MFCCs. And then I noticed that, you know, loudness is quite random. So maybe I should give loudness features to the machine so that maybe it would have a little bit more understanding of the loudness. And then lastly, I noticed that the durations were really almost like a car going fast and then stopping and then going fast. It was like really disruptive. So I decided to add the duration of an audio segment as well. In that sense, this is the general view of the algorithm. And here at the top, we have an audio recording. And the audio recording is first goes through segmentation to come up with the single sound samples that we see on B. And then using these samples, I'm creating a sound memory. That's the discrete latent space of audio. And here in each square is a cluster of sounds. In there you have up to between 2 and 5 sounds. And using these clusters, I go back to the original recording and I label each segment with the cluster number. So it's almost like clustering these different audio samples and then almost trying to define what kind of sounds they are for the machine. And then from there, you end up with a symbolic representation of the audio, original audio recording. And then this representation is almost like a some form of representation of the musical form there. So what we have here is the organization in time. And once you have this representation, you can actually use different algorithms for that are called statistical sequence generation algorithms. They are more like compression algorithms, right? If you make a zip file, you use some of those algorithms actually. It looks at the text, it understands the patterns that, so that you're, and then it decreases, compresses your data so that it's a smaller size. And those compression algorithms are actually, they are trying to find patterns within a string. And I used them for music because, you know, that's what I needed. I needed to understand patterns in a string of numbers. And this is the main idea of Masom, of this algorithm. And then how do we play with it though? How was the playing? So there's an input to the algorithm. After the training, this was the training procedure. And we created the sound memory, we created the musical structure memory. And then after the training, in the live performance, what happens is the algorithm has an input, that's the music input. And then in that input, I have segmentation and audio feature extraction happening, which is in real time, it's trying to understand the sound samples from the input audio, and it's also labeling those sound samples. And the labeling is actually trying to find where that sound sample is in the memory of the agent. And that is actually a number. And then the algorithm keeps a track of those numbers. Let's say, you know, 2 sounds ago, it was 8. And then after that, it was 5. And after that, we observed now 5. And what is going to be the next one? So it goes back to the memory. And then if we see here, after 8 and 5, we can have 7. Or here, after 8 and 5, we can have 2. This is actually a short composition by Zenekis, and I actually trained this, and this is actually what the algorithm came up with. So in live performance, let's say, okay, it's looking at the history and it's like, okay, it was 8, now it is 5. You know what? If that's the case, I'm going to play either 7 or 2. And then let's say it's choosing 7, and then this number is actually representing a cluster of audio samples. And from those samples, it's choosing 1 to play with, and that becomes the output. That's how I play with it. And the whole process goes back again. And this is happening in real time. It might be a little bit, you know, quite a lot to grasp at once, but let's see it in action, right? So for the first attempt, for its first concert, I trained the algorithm on this very noisy improvisation of mine, and I'm here. I'm improvising solo. It's a little bit noisy. Just a heads up. So let me give you a little bit of an introduction to that. So this was my solo improvisation, and this was a 30-minute recording or something. And then I trained the algorithm with it, and then I decided to improvise with the algorithm in a sort of like a similar manner. But this time, we are both live. You will hear me playing on one channel and the algorithm playing on another channel. So first, the algorithm will start. I'm not going to play all of this, but you know, this was the first concert of this approach. And then this was great, but I was using this approach for more of a shorter performance pieces, like let's say maximum 15 minutes. And then I wanted to make longer performances. I also wanted to have a little bit of, you know, more control on the algorithm's output. But I also wanted to try like generating different styles. And one idea was that, hey, can I generate maybe something more rhythmic, something on more on a steady tempo? And then I did some experiments on that. Let's see here. And this evolved into an artwork, but there were some catches or tricks that I've done here. And first one was that constraining the organization in time, the models for musical structure or musical form, was really important to obtain that consistency in the system's output. When I mention consistency, it's almost like, you don't want the algorithm to go everywhere. You don't want the algorithm to make, ambient music for 10 seconds and then go super noisy for 30 seconds, because you want a little bit of those changes more on a, long-term manner. And that's hard to get in musical AI. And my trick to do that was by making the data set of sound organization or sound memory really big, but making the data set of musical structure or musical form really constrained, well picked, and well created. That really helped. And then also, I could train the musical form model very quickly in milliseconds. So in performances, actually, I train the model just before it starts playing. And then it's almost like you can change the style of the generative algorithm in real time during the performances. And this really allowed for me to obtain more of a consistent output from the architecture. And neither is better than the other. It just fits different artistic concepts. So this is, I'm not saying that this is better than the other. But if we think about it, there's one interesting catch here. If you think about human perception, we know quite a bit of sounds, but we don't use them for each composition, right? Or each artwork. I mean, I can make noise music, but if I'm making more of a, an ambient piece, I'm probably not going to use my skills for noise music improvisation. So we are, I think we are also constrained when we are making our when we are creating our artworks as humans. So that kind of ideology resonated with me, and I kind of tried to have that as an inspiration for making the algorithm. And then we also made a dome piece around that. And here, in time, actually, I just changed my interaction with the algorithm. Initially, my interaction with the algorithm was through the audio, through playing, through improvising. But here it was more of actually guiding the algorithm by training its musical form or musical structure in real time with the content that I knew before, that I created before. And let's hear that a little bit. So three people playing here, not just one algorithm. And those bird-like sounds are coming from muscle. And this was actually what I was trying to get, because it was a 45-minute piece, and I was trying to obtain sort of consistency in some sections so that sounds are really well blended. They are part of almost one. And that was why I come up with a different type of interaction with the machine other than audio interaction or live improvisation. I'm going to quickly skip the details of this. We have a whole queue system going on that's changing the agent's musical form, musical structure training, and all that. And there are like different research questions here, but for the sake of the time, I'm just going to pass and go into another work that's called Plastic Biosphere, which was actually recently premiered this summer. The second version of it, number two, and the first version was presented back in I think 2020 maybe summer, when I did the virtual artist residency, because it was COVID, with Nicola actually. And in this piece there is something really interesting happened, where I changed the initial structures of the algorithm. But before talking about that, I want to give a little bit of, you know, content from this piece so that you have a little bit of an idea about how it feels. Music here completely generated by Mason. There's a little bit of reverb added. So in this was number one, where I use Mason to have, you know, so much content for an interactive artwork. When someone goes in front of the piece, their silhouette appears on the piece, and a new instance of the agent playing starting. So it was really cool, because, you know, I can't be there all the time and play some things, but yeah, I have this like autonomous algorithm that kind of creates variety in musical output for participants to enjoy. And then in the second version, I produce this audiovisual performance piece. And that interaction was really interesting, because using the algorithm, I could generate a bunch of different, you know, what I call musical snippets. And that was a really fun way of actually producing, because I really don't like starting from silence if I'm producing something. And I like to have a couple of, you know, different ideas in front of me and then choosing between them. Like, I really like that iterative design process, as opposed to starting something from blank. And the algorithm really helped me in that. And I think that was a really fun process. So what I come up with at the end is, you know, having algorithm generating a musical sort of background, sort of like laying out the ground. And I have the flexibility to play on top of that. Let's see that a little bit. So we will hear a particular section from the Plastic Biosphere number two. It's going to start in a second now. This is the musical foundation that I call, generated by the algorithm. Mm-hmm. bit forward. There's also a dancer in real time making these effects on the visuals. Anyhow, so this was also a different way of using a musical AI for production of an AV, long AV piece that was, and this piece was an hour long, I think. I still have it, the premiere recording of the premiere on YouTube. If you are interested, please let me know and I'm happy to share. And there was something interesting here that I did in the in the internal mechanics of the algorithm. So previously, the sound memory and musical structure memory was using the same recording. Let's say if I'm training the algorithm on Zenekis or Stockhausen, it's using the same sounds from Zenekis or Stockhausen. And sometimes you can't tell those sounds if you are really familiar with the content. And also, it didn't give me that much of a flexibility because sometimes I don't want some of those sounds because they have too much familiarity. So what I did here was actually training the sound memory on a data set of audio samples that are not in the compositions. So I come up with, you know, a bunch of audio samples, collected them, gigabytes of audio samples, and created the sound memory. But then I went to using this sound memory structure, I could still go to those compositions, create these representation of those compositions, and then use the musical and train a model to capture the musical structure or the musical form. That was really interesting, and I think I'm raising some ethical questions here, where we need to discuss what musical form is, and also we need to discuss the ownership of musical forms, because this is basically capturing someone else's musical composition in a representation manner. But then can we claim ownership on that? Because, you know, we have also musical forms such as sonats or chorales, then that are, you know, no one would say that chorale is mine, no one else can use it. There's no such thing. So there are some ownership questions there that I'm really interested into looking into. And then also, you know, there are questions related to human computer interaction there too, because there were all these different types of interaction modalities that I came up with through this research through design process. And that was the discrete latent audio space sort of research, which is still ongoing. But then I also wanted to have continuous latent audio space research. I wanted a continuous latent audio space because, you know, I wanted to have more control on the sonic gestures instead of having a fixed sound sample. And here we see the discrete latent audio space and each square here representing a couple of audio samples, which are a couple of seconds. In continuous latent space, we have a different representation. Here, each circle, by circle I mean these tiny ones, not the squiggles, each circle is an audio chunk. It's around 5 milliseconds. And then these squiggles are actually audio samples. And this was really interesting because I am not giving the computer these squiggles. It kind of organized chunks from an audio sample closer to each other. And then these paths emerged from that. And here each path is an audio sample actually. And this is a continuous parametric latent space. And that research is latent timber synthesis. It was published in 2020, last year. And the code, by the way, for everything that I do, all these algorithms, the code is open source. You can find it on GitHub if you're interested. Here, I use the deep learning algorithm that is called variational Lotta encoders. And I trained a variational Lotta encoder on a particular type of spectrogram. It's a wavelet-based spectrogram. It's called constant Q transform spectrogram. It's very well known in music information retrieval because, you know, it's been proven to be a good, like it's been proven to be successful in different applications for music information retrieval. So I decided to use that. In my case, it was also really cool. The outputs were really interesting. And in this continuous latent space, I was interested in doing interpolations between sound. For example, here we have a blue sound, which is a recording, and then a red one. And then this green one is generated between taking each chunk from each audio and then finding the midpoint of those points, of those chunks in the latent space, and then from there generating the sound. And then there's also a, you know, user interface around it. I think it's better if I show a video of how this works than explaining. We choose one chunk of an audio, then another section, let's say section of an audio. And here I think they are like just a second or two. Oh, 4.36 seconds. And then we have in between an interpolation curve, which is deciding how much it should take from each sample per audio chunk. And this is really interesting because it is fast. I haven't done it, but this to generate a 2 second long audio, it takes 1 second to compute it. So that's fast. That's almost indicating that you could perhaps have real time applications of this. But for this first approach, this research has been done during my visiting researcher position at ZHDK, Zurich University of the Arts, in collaboration with Daniel Bissig. And this was our first attempt. You know, we made the model, we realized that we can make some cool sounds with the model. So we made a very fast user interface for it so that we could work with composers and to see if they find it interesting or not. So this is still an ongoing work. Although this one is published, the whole research on continuous using continuous latent audio space, still an ongoing work. And then there are many things that I want to do for next steps. For example, trying adversarial variation autoencoders, if you want to get into the specifics. I also want to work with the phase reconstruction part, which is the slowest part on this path. And then using maybe another deep learning algorithm to make that faster. And they have done it actually for speech already. So maybe it could work for music too. Sorry. And then from there, Daniel Bissig, who was collaborating with me on latent timbre synthesis, he's also a Marie Curie fellow right now on movement computation. And we did this work called Music Follows Movement. And then here we use this similar approach to latent timbre synthesis, but then we are controlling the variational autoencoder using another deep learning algorithm that handles modeling a movement sequence. Not going to get into the details of it, but basically it's combining what we call sequence-to-sequence architecture with a variational autoencoder for audio synthesis. And I just want to show a little bit of its outputs. That is, so the training data set is a synchronized data set where you have movement sequences synchronized with audio. And let's see. And once you train the model, you can actually input any movement to it to synthesize sound. And these were the results of our initial attempts, and we have a publication at this, sorry, we have a publication at this year's AI Music Creativity Conference. If you're interested, you can find the details there. And there are quite a bit of future research on this that we want to try, you know, different input modalities as opposed to motion capture. And then we want to try different models other than a simple sequence-to-sequence model. We also want to change the variational autoencoder sound synthesis part and make it maybe trying to make it higher quality. And we also want to make musical performances. We haven't done musical performances with this yet. It's going to be fun, I think. And then if I move into my future research and cover them very, very quickly, I'm also in all research in both MESOM and latent timbre synthesis and all that, I was taking each audio recording as if it's a one layer of musical action, but in general, it's not. And there was a reason behind that, because source separation, that's called source separation in musical information retrieval. Source separation was back then still, you know, it was okay, but there wasn't that much of an algorithm to actually do something cool with it. But today we have it. So I want to actually move into more of a multi-layered representations of music where you have multiple layers and then musical actions, sonic gestures are happening in those layers, sometimes at the same time. And then this indicates also using hierarchical machine learning models where you have multiple layers as an input, and then you can, you know, capture the dependencies or interactions or relations between layers. I'm also interested in, I'm constantly working on audio synthesis using deep learning algorithms, aka raw audio generation. And I think it's a fun area because, you know, I'm at the core of my research questions, I'm really interested in using raw audio with unsupervised learning algorithms. And recently, I'm also accepted for an artist residency at ZKM as a part of a project called On the Fly. And hopefully, I will be combining, I will be researching live coding as an interaction technique with latent timbre synthesis. We'll see how it will go. And this will happen in January next year. And coming back to it, this is pretty much a brief summary of my research activities. I hope it was somehow useful or interesting to you. Thank you.